Hey guys, critical reasoning video. It's pretty brief. I have two questions, one paragraph, the regular drill, right? So you can take a look at the question first, pause the video and read it. This is the first paragraph. This is the question related to that particular excerpt. And then this is the second paragraph passage. And then this is the question to this particular excerpt, okay? So you can pause it, you know the drill, right? And then try to solve it on your own. A couple of things, we've been doing quite a bit of this on this channel, critical reasoning questions. The idea is to help you. It's critical reasoning, the theory, there's not a lot of theory in critical reasoning. Yes, if you take notes and probably summarize all the, you know, whatever I've discussed in all the questions, you will find a few, you know, essential rules. But by and large, critical reasoning is nothing more than being able to read well and being able to understand how much whatever you're reading can be extended to or extrapolated to. As you would know, right, authors, especially when the text is dense, you know that the authors are not saying all the things that they need to say. Sometimes they assume that you understand it, or sometimes they leave some things unsaid. So critical reasoning is the art of being able to understand all that unsaid information. Though the unsaid information is the one that you know, questions are posed on in the exams, especially in CAT or GMAT, okay, or any particular in that okay, so any exam in which there are critical reasoning questions. So the idea is to see if you can, while reading itself in a general way, really, not just when you're solving these questions, when there is an assumption question or when there's an inference question, but by and large, whenever you're reading, the idea is to be able to see if you are getting better at reading. Getting better at reading means comprehending what you're reading, which is part one, which is whatever is there directly, can you understand? The ability to understand what else this can be extended to. Whatever you're reading, can I extend it to anything more and identify more piece of information? And number three, the ability to grasp on what basis the author has made the arguments that you're reading. Okay, author, not all the authors always give you all the pieces of information because they're writing for their target audience. Okay, and their target audience probably could be scholars, could be PhD students, could be people who've already read enough about the subject, but you are looking at the passage the first time in the exam, right? So the idea is CAT takes care of it, or GMAT takes care of it. When you get the excerpt, there is no outside information that you need to know. Even whatever questions they pose, those questions are questions for which the answers are hidden inside the paragraph itself. Those are called the assumptions, right? So you try to build on all of that. Anyways, look at the first one, to Karnak, which is the name of a particular person's critique of philosophers. Karnak and many others, much metaphysical thought was bullshit, which is a strong negative word. To put a slightly finer point on it, Karnak thought that most of what philosophers do when they write about metaphysics, is composed semantically empty sentences. Empty is an active word, by the way, which he calls pseudo statements. So the essence of what Carnap writes is that a lot of metaphysics that is being written by philosophers is bullshit. Okay, sentences of this metaphysical flavor appear to say something profound. See, now good readers don't have to go beyond it. From just this one word here, appear to say something profound itself, you know that Carnap does not actually agree that they are profound. When I say appears, it means there's always a doubt, right? That's why this emphasis on the word appear. Appear to say something profound since they are grammatically correct, which means grammar is indeed important, or something that is semantically correct or grammatically correct generally gives the appearance of being profound or deep or meaningful. But you know that twist is coming, right? Because but is your contrast marker. But careful investigation reveals that not only is nothing profound being said, nothing is being said at all. It's not just that whatever is being said does not have anything deep. It also doesn't have anything on the surface. Or basically, it doesn't have anything. Just mumbo jumbo, but grammatically correct sentences. Metaphysics, whatever authors, philosophers write in terms of metaphysics, okay? And philosophers should say things that are meaningful. That's why this guy is not a big fan of whatever philosophers write about metaphysics, because according to him, philosophers should be writing stuff that is profound or that is meaningful. Make sense? Let's look at the question. Which of the following, if proven false, will refute Carnap's argument? Okay, stay a little, be careful about questions like these. Although they're not difficult, they look or sound difficult because there are multiple twists. but if you break down, you'll understand what they mean. Okay, which of the following, if proven false, okay, will refute. Refute means basically saying that Carnap's argument is wrong, refute or repudiate or invalidate. Okay, so if the statement is proven false, then it will refute Carnap's argument. Just an indirect way of asking which of the following is an assumption in the earlier paragraph, because that's the very definition of an assumption. The fundamental meaning of the critical reasoning term assumption is the statement which has to be true for the whole argument to be true. Okay, so if that statement is proven false, then the argument falls apart. So we are looking for something that makes Carnap's argument correct. Okay, that's, you have to make that translation in your head before you go to the options, right? Grammatically correct statements always sound more profound. We always is a problematic part. So what does the statement mean? The statement means that if a statement is grammatically correct, it will sound deep. What was the paragraph talking about? If you remember, paragraph was saying because they're grammatically correct, some of those metaphysical statements sounded profound. Okay, but that does not rely on the basic assumption that grammatically correct statements are always sounding profound. In metaphysics, whatever philosophers write sounds profound because they're grammatically correct. Okay, but by and large, grammatically correct statements don't always have to be sounding more profound, isn't it? So this is a statement. What do you call this? Is called extreme exaggeration. Okay, it goes way outside the scope of the actual paragraph, because we are talking about philosophers writing about their metaphysical thoughts. We are talking about that much. So I can't take grammatical statements as a generic idea and then say they always sound more profound. What about the grammatically correct statements written in geography, for example? Okay. So you can't make a call on that, right? So you can eliminate option A, not a big problem. Sentences of metaphysical flavor can be objectively dissected for their profundity. Okay, this sentence itself sounds tricky, but if you break it down, you'll understand what it's trying to say. Whenever some option sounds very dense or tricky, don't get turned off and say, this doesn't seem okay. Don't go by your gut feeling till you understand the meaning of a sentence. Only when you understand the meanings of all the options do you earn the right to pick an answer. Okay, so sentences of metaphysical flavor, we know that the paragraph is talking about that, isn't it? So I can stop this part here. This part is not necessarily that important. I know what we are talking about, right? Sentence of metaphysical flavor. These sentences can be objectively dissected for their profundity. Let's say the statement is false. They cannot be objectively dissected. If they cannot be objectively dissected, how can I decide whether they're meaningful or not meaningful? I cannot figure out that they're meaningful or not meaningful. If sentences cannot be objectively dissected and means that I cannot look at a sentence and decide this is meaningful for everybody, if I can't say that, then Carnap's argument will also become false, because Carnap's saying they don't say anything meaningful. When Carnap is saying they don't say anything meaningful on careful investigation, what does it mean? It means that it is possible that someone can look at the sentence and decide whether they're profound or not. What if there is a scenario where the sentence is meaningless for you but meaningful for somebody else? That's called objectively, that will be subjective, right? So objectively dissecting for the profundity should be possible for somebody like Carnap to say they are not meaningful. You understand? It's like saying this collection of books does not have any classics. The statement can be true only if there are a set of books which are classics, isn't it? Then only I can decide whether the set of books here has classics or doesn't have classics. Make sense? So B is a very strong candidate. If proven false, it will refute. If this is false, that it cannot be if it cannot be objectively dissected, then Carnap's argument will also be false, because how did Carnap then know that, you know, these sentences are not meaningful or profound? Next, philosophers should not make pseudo statements. Should not is a problem here. You can immediately eliminate this option, because the question is not about what they should or shouldn't do. The question is about what they do already. So philosophers shouldn't make pseudo statements. Philosophers, they shouldn't be making pseudo statements. Why? Okay. Philosophers, when they write about metaphysics, make pseudo statements is something that is stated in the paragraph. This is saying thing. No, they should not be doing it. This doesn't have any bearing on Carnap's argument in general, isn't it? Because Carnap's argument is about the meaning of that metaphysical thought, which Carnap thinks is zero, okay? Zero meaning and zero sense to it. So C is not such a big problem. So you can eliminate this option. All meaningful statements are grammatically correct. Now, if all meaningful statements are not grammatically correct, then the paragraph goes into the direction of the connection of grammar and meaning, okay? But grammar and meaning is not the argument of the paragraph. The argument of the paragraph is metaphysical sentences are not profound. Okay, why did grammar even come to the picture? The sentences look like they have meaning because they are grammatically correct. Okay, the sentences look like they have meaning because they are grammatically correct. Doesn't mean that if something is not grammatically correct, it won't have meaning. The appearance of profundity or the appearance of saying something major is coming from the fact that they're grammatically correct. Okay, so that appearance may not always be there, but a sentence could still be profound. Look at all the set cases, right? B, the appearance of B is because of A. In this case, in metaphysical thought, doesn't mean always has to be A to lead back to B, right? So all those critical reasoning principles, when A leads to B, does not necessarily mean B leads back to A, things like that. So all meaningful statements is actually making it a little easier for you. If I remove all, then it becomes a trickier option, okay? Some meaningful statements are grammatically correct, okay? If I say that, some meaningful statements are grammatically correct. But the question here is, if proven false will refute Carnap's argument. Some meaningful statements are grammatically correct. If proven false, what does it mean? No meaningful statement is grammatically correct. It will go into that direction. No meaningful statement is grammatically correct. So here Carnap is saying that these statements are grammatically correct. Therefore, they're not. So you understand, right? So going into entirely different territory just by changing the scope defining word all or some. But because all is already there, makes our life a little easier. Okay. So all meaningful statements are grammatically correct. Let's say I prove this false. What does it mean? All meaningful statements are not grammatically correct, okay? Which means there are meaningful statements which are not grammatically correct. But Carnap's argument was not about grammar and meaning connection. They said these appear to have some meaning because they're grammatically correct. Doesn't talk about those statements which have meaning but are not grammatically correct. He's talking about statements which are grammatically correct but don't have meaning. Yes, two different sets. We should not confuse each other. It's basically like remembering the affirmation of consequent, right? You do not assume that the reverse is true. That's what you're trying to say. Okay, I won't go out because it is raining. Classic example. I won't go out because it is raining, or I don't go out when it is raining. Okay, when it is not raining, what do? You cannot take a prediction, isn't it? That's a different set altogether. So that way you can eliminate option D. You don't have to really worry about option D because the argument itself is not about the connection between grammar and meaning. Okay, metaphysical thought could be too abstract to derive meaning from. If proven false, what does it mean? It's not abstract enough. It means metaphysical thought can have meaning. If proven false, doesn't say anything about Carnap's argument, because Carnap says most of the metaphysical argument is bullshit, not saying all of metaphysical thought is bullshit. So even proven false tells you that metaphysical thought can have some meaning at the end of it. If proven false, that's what it's saying, can have some meaning. Carnap's argument is that most of metaphysical thought is bullshit because they're just grammatical. So again, those two don't overlap. What he's trying to say and what Carnap's argument is not trying to overlap. I'm saying most of it is bullshit because just right grammatically correct stuff, but again, you cannot really, find meaning in it. Second part is proven false. It means it will slightly strengthen Carnap's argument in that it says metaphysical argument is not too abstract, meaning I can understand what it is talking about. Then it kind of strengthens Carnap's argument because Carnap's whole argument is based on the assumption that we can understand what the metaphysics is if you dig deeper and then be able to tell whether it has meaning or not. Okay, it's a little complicated. I hope it makes sense to you. Anyway, so the answer to this particular question will be option B. Apologies. The answer to this particular question is option B. Let's look at the next question. It was only 400,000 years ago that several species of man, this is from Sapiens, okay? It's a wonderful, wonderful non-fiction read if you're looking for something good for non-fiction, in terms of CAT preparation. It's full of reading comprehension, anthropology passages, okay? It was only 400,000 years ago that several species of man began to hunt large game on a regular basis. Hunt large game means hunt bigger animals. And only in the last 10,000 years, see, watch out for this stuff, okay? Never read in one go, comma and so full stop. So it's only 400,000 years ago that several species of man began to hunt large game. Only in the last 100,000 years that man jumped to the top of the food chain with the rise of Homo sapiens. There's a beautiful assumption here, okay, that someone like, in the context, the readers will understand it. You as an aspirant, if you're only looking at this particular paragraph as a test taker, you'll not understand it. So you'll have to be able to catch stuff like this. With the rise of Homo sapiens, that man jumped to the top of the food chain. It means these two are not the same. Okay. So if I go by the context of the passage, obviously in Sapiens, Harari talks about how Homo is a genus and Homo sapiens is just one of only one type of humans. There are other types as well. It refers to human being species, the Homo sapiens, as sapiens. That's why he doesn't refer to them as humans. Okay, that is the context. But even if you did not, even if you did not understand that, here you should be able to understand it. In the last 100,000 years, with the rise of Homo sapiens, man jumped to the top of food chain. Which is, man is also there before the rise of Homo sapiens, which means there are other species included apart from Homo species under the term man. Okay, that spectacular leap from the middle to the top had enormous consequences. Other animals at the top of the pyramid, such as lions and sharks, evolved into that position very gradually. This enabled the ecosystem to develop checks and balances that prevent lions and sharks from wreaking too much havoc. Okay, so you understand this is again a classic assumption that when an animal, which is understood, but you should be able to grasp it. When an animal rises to the top of the, or becomes the apex predator, alongside there is a parallel process where the ecosystem develops checks and balances to make sure everyone else around evolves as well, so that doesn't wreak havoc. If one species evolves and the other species does not evolve around it, then the species will wreak havoc. Okay, so this enabled the ecosystem to develop by millions of years. They evolved over millions of years. As lions became deadlier, so gazelles evolved to run faster, hyenas to cooperate better, rhinoceros to be more bad-tempered. So all the other animals around also evolved. In contrast, so you know how it is different in case of human beings, right? In contrast, humankind ascended to the top so quickly that the ecosystem was not given time to adjust. Okay, so which means others did not evolve as fast, which means I can infer that human beings have wreaked havoc or can wreak havoc. Moreover, humans themselves failed to adjust. Most top predators of the planet are majestic creatures. Millions of years of dominion have filled them with self-confidence. Sapiens, by contrast, more like a banana republic dictator. Banana republic, a lot of instability, okay, not good governance, something that's everything could turn topsy-turvy, volatile, all of that, okay. Google banana, it's pretty interesting term. Having so recently been one of the underdogs of the savannah, we are full of fears and anxieties over our position, which makes us doubly cruel and dangerous. Can you see the connection? See, this is how assumptions are hidden. Okay, when keywords which happens, we have fears and anxieties over position, which makes us cruel and dangerous. The author is telling you that there's some connection between these two. Okay. Many historical calamities, from deadly wars to ecological catastrophes, have resulted from this over hasty jump. What did the over hasty jump caused us to not have enough confidence, led us to having fears and anxieties, led us to being doubly dangerous and cruel. Okay, so wars, so you can see the connection, right? Wars, ecological catastrophes have been connected to our fears, anxieties, and our sense of cruelty and whatnot. Okay, let's look at the question. Which of the following cannot be inferred from the passage? So three of the four are true. Always read cannot be inferred as, which of the following I can understand as true from the parables. You don't have to go deep into the meaning of did he use the word inferred or concluded or understood or assumed. At the end of the day, they're all asking the same question. Which of the following you can understand as true, but the passage did not give it, but you still know it's true, like that. Okay. The more time an apex predator spends at the top of the food chain, the more confidence it builds. It's something I can understand to be true, because that's, the paragraph clearly says that other apex predators are majestic creatures, because millions of years of dominion has filled them with confidence, which means that the more they are at the top, the more confident they are, isn't it? Which makes absolute sense. So this can be inferred. Wars are caused by our fears and insecurities. Again, it becomes a small vocab check, and I'll be really disappointed if you said not be because I see insecurities here, which is a new term or an alien term. That's not true. Okay? Anxieties about our positions is an insecurity. So sometimes are different words given, but the meaning is pretty much the same. Okay, so don't look for new. Don't just look at a new word and eliminate the option. You are instead trying to understand what it means. Okay, so our fears and anxieties about our positions are the same as fears and insecurities. Wars are caused by it. Yes. Okay. Not necessarily all wars, but at least some wars. He makes a generic statement. It doesn't emphasize on the fact that every war is caused by it. Says wars are caused by our fears and insecurities. Yes, maybe. Our cruelty stems from our fears and anxieties. Okay. This is the other. Here, if you notice, I did not give the whole thing. Anxieties about what? About our position is what the passage is talking about. So there are a lot of different other anxieties. Problem number one, red flag. You can't eliminate the option using that. What I would hope you have caught on is this part. Okay. It basically becomes a ratio and proportion question. Okay. If you go back to the paragraph, what does the paragraph say? We are full of fears and anxieties, which makes us doubly cruel and dangerous. Okay. Whatever we are, the fears and anxieties make us doubly cruel and dangerous. Doubly cruel and dangerous, compare, there are two open questions here, right? Doubly cruel and dangerous, so double of what? What we are originally, or probably means because we became an apex predator, whatever our original nature was, we became more cruel and more dangerous. It's also quite possible. One of the other ways of reading it is doubly cruel and dangerous compared to the other apex predators. That is also possible. Irrespective of how you understand it, we cannot infer that cruelty stems from that fear and anxiety. Okay, cruel, we become more cruel and more dangerous is different from saying the cruelty comes from the fear and anxiety. You understand the difference? So our cruelty does not stem from it. Our fears and anxieties make us doubly cruel and more dangerous. That's all it says. So where the cruelty comes from, we don't know the source. Okay, can you spot something like this in the first read? You cannot. Okay, you won't be able to. It's way too small and way too tricky to be able to catch something like this. And sometimes you read it and you say, yeah, it's fair enough. Yeah, if we're becoming doubly cruel and dangerous because of our fears and anxieties, maybe I can say that we became cruel because of anxiety. But if you go a little deeper, you know that we did not become cruel because of the anxiety, right? It makes us more dangerous. It makes us more cruel, okay? More cruel or more dangerous compared to when the fears and anxieties are not there. So the fear and anxiety is making us more of what we already are. But where did it original come from? We don't know, isn't it? So stems from is the problem. But how will you catch it? You will catch it when you compare with the options. How true is A? How true is B? How true is D? Okay, it's more like a comparison option. Directly on spot, you can't really say C stands out, others are not. Okay, it's very difficult. We compare. Okay, wars are caused by our fears and insecurities. Yes. Evolution of top predators sparks the creation of checks and balance in the ecosystem. Yes, the passage mentions that. So A and D are actually very direct. Okay, I pretty much understand in the passage because the passage says other animals are majestic because they have been filled with confidence for millions of years, which means the time is important. The millions of years were stressed. So A can be removed. Similarly, D, in case of human beings, there wasn't enough time to create checks and balances. So evolution sparks the creation of checks and balances in the ecosystem is also true. Okay, it takes time also. The evolution of top predators sparks the creation of checks and balance in the ecosystem. It takes time. But it's true that sparks the evolution, isn't it? So in this case, we didn't have enough time. In this case, if you go back to, this is the other important point I want you to remember, okay? What does it say? Humankind ascended to the top. So the ecosystem was not given time to adjust. Not say ecosystem did not adjust. It's not given enough time to adjust, which means time is important. So the evolution of top predators sparks the creation of checks and balances, yes. But in case of human beings, we did not have enough time, okay? So D can't be, you can't say D is wrong. D is true, except in case of other animals, there was time. In case of human beings, there wasn't much time. Wars are caused by our fears and insecurities, and C, both look very close, right? So you just do a B minus C. What do you understand? What's the difference between B and C? One is saying wars, one is saying our cruelty, okay? So in the end, goes down to, can I really compare these two and go back to the original sentence and read the original sentence and see where the problem is? On the first reading, you'll never be able to spot and say C is the answer because it looks the most familiar, okay? But all anxieties, number one, problem number one, it's just anxieties about our positions that the passage is talking about, position as the top predator, that should warn you a little bit. Bigger thing is you should go back and see where exactly has C come from, is what? Is it exactly saying the same thing that I'm thinking? Okay, our cruelty doesn't stem from our fears and anxieties. Our fears and anxieties make us doubly cruel and dangerous. Okay, so the answer to this particular question, so A can be inferred, D can be inferred. These are the two easy options to eliminate. Okay, these two a little closer because you may think, is it all wars? Is it some wars? But at the end of it, look at what the author is saying. Many historical calamities, from deadly wars to ecological catastrophes. The author is not really saying that there are wars which can be caused without fears and anxieties. So I can by and large make this inference that wars are caused by fears and insecurities. This is what the author would agree with. Okay. So the answer to this particular question will be, option C. Okay. That brings us to the end of this video. Hope you could make some sense out of it. Until next time, peace out.